it says the communication of our faith becomes effective when we acknowledge every good thing that we have in Christ. There's something powerful when we start to acknowledge how good and how awesome God is. And we have a lot to be thankful for. The world that we live in is a negative world. The enemy tries to draw us to the negative. Oh, this pain. You got 99% of your body's working great, and the devil's, oh, there's a little sore foot over there. There's a little toe over there. But Jesus is a positive God. He's positive. And there's something positive. When he took those loaves and there's only a few, instead of complaining and saying, how am I going to feed all these multitudes with these loaves? He said, he gave thanks. There's something powerful when we acknowledge and we thank God. Amen? So we're going to just sing this together. Let's just give thanks. And as we're singing this song, I want you to thank God for your husband. Thank God for your wife. Thank God for your kids. Thank God for your health. Amen? But you're like, well, Pastor, I got some problems. How many know God's already saw the answer? The answer's already provided for. And just begin by faith to begin to thank the Lord that you got the victory. You're not trying to get it. You got it. Ready? Take a little time. Come on now.
I just want to take a little time right now to say thank you, Lord, for what you've done for me. I just want to take a little time right now to say thank you.
Is in you.
Greater ones in me. The mighty Holy Spirit.
How many are excited about that? I'm not afraid.
And
excited about that. Let's sing it again.
Worshiping there, just praising the Lord. You know, God wants to move. How many know the Holy Spirit wants to move? And as I was worshiping the Lord, and just be ready, because sometimes when this starts to happen, it's like opening a well, just like something starts to open up. But I really felt like in my spirit that somebody's got something going on with their knee. And if that's you, just raise your hand, because we're going to see God do something wonderful this morning. Your knee, who is it? Right over there. Well, there's a couple there. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to stand there. Wow, there's a few here. Or there's, wow, whew, just, all right, you're ready. Here's what I want you, stand up. And just right now, you're gonna receive what's already done.
Hallelujah.
You're going to just receive it. You're just going to receive it, right? Thank you, Lord. Father, right now, such as you've given to us, Lord, you said in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, knees right now, pain gone in Jesus' name. And we speak to the marrow, we speak to the muscles, we speak to the joints, normal in Jesus' name. We declare the decree of God, and we thank you, Father, that these people are the healed of the Lord in Jesus' name.
The greater ones in me.
Somebody here, their ears. Something's going on with their ear. There's a sharp pain in your ear. Who is it? Quickly. Sharp pain in your ear. Who is it? Maybe it's somebody watching. You need to let us know. But somebody here, sharp pain in your ear. Just raise your hand. Lift it up.
Lord, I know you're faithful.
Who is it? Come on, raise your hand. Sharp pain, sharp pain. You got arthritis? Well, Lord, take care of that too. Isn't it great? It's not in your ear though, right? All right. Well, how many know God will take care of our right? He's already taken care of it, right? All right, we're gonna give it to her, right? Are you ready, dear sister? Yes, Lord. Such as we have, we give it to you right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, we command that arthritis to leave this body in Jesus' name. We speak to every bone and we say normal, every joint, every normal, every in between of the, everything's normal in Jesus' name. We speak the life and the power of God right now in Jesus' name. Now you just say, I receive.
I got it.
And whatever area where you are, so you start moving it now. And you let us know while I'm talking. You can just say, Pastor, pain is gone in Jesus' name. You can let us know. Just let us know, because I know God is working. God is working. Hallelujah. How many are excited about the Lord and what God is doing? Amen? Hallelujah. Josiah, awesome job, buddy. Thank you, sir. Thank you. All right, you guys ready for some word today? Let's go. That's right. I like that. Let's go. Right? Amen. Let's go. We're gonna get the word today. The Bible says he sent his word and delivered them and brought healing to the people. And so we're going to just get right into it right now. Cassie, let's go to the first slide. And if you weren't here last week, I'd encourage you to listen to it. Because the reason why I want you to listen to last week's message, and again, we'll kind of highlight a little bit as God leads, is that this week is number two, right? So last week there was a whole teaching on this. And how many are excited that we have the power and the authority in the name of Jesus?
Yes.
Notice what it says here. I want you to see it. Go with me over to James, the fourth chapter, verse number 7. James, the fourth chapter, verse number 7. So again, if you weren't here, you can go on our Facebook page. You can go on our YouTube channel. You can go to our website, familyoasis.org. You can pull it up, look at that. I'd encourage you to do it. And how many know just because you heard something doesn't mean you got it? Jesus said, if you continue in the word, you'll know the truth. The word know is not just simply knowing with head knowledge. It's a knowing like a husband and a wife know each other. It's like we are so connected and there's such an intimacy that we have. And that's what God wants us to have with his word. He wants us to have not just the head knowledge of the word, but that word is so entwined with us. It's engrafted in us that the seed of God, we receive the seed of God's word and that word is producing life in our body. Amen. Notice what it says here. It says, submit yourself. Everybody say, submit yourself.
Submit yourself.
To God. And we talked about this, so we won't go more. Again, listen last week. But notice what he says here. He says, resist the devil.
Amen. Hallelujah.
And he will flee from
you.
Now, he's talking to the individual here, and he's saying, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Notice the word for resist and flee. I just want you to see it. Slide number 7. How many love the word?
Amen.
Everybody say, resist the devil.
Resist the devil.
The word resist means to set yourself against. It means to withstand. It means to oppose. In other words, there's opposition coming this way, and we're to oppose it with something going this way. That's the word. That's the faith. Peter says, resist him steadfast in the faith. In other words, you're resisting him with the word. And he says, if we'll do that, stand against the devil, he will what? Flee from you. Now, what if you and I don't resist the devil?
He's going to hang around.
He's going to hang around. Right? You and I have to resist the devil for ourselves. And how does he come? He comes with lies. He comes with thoughts. He comes with feelings. He comes with emotion. He'll come with little visions in your head. And when a thought comes to you, a feeling comes to you that's contrary to the Word of God, you and I have to actively oppose him and resist him. Amen. And if we don't do it, like John said, he'll just hang around and it'll get worse. If you get a feeling of fear, you're not just supposed to go, well, that's who I am. You're going to fight it. You're going to stand against it in the name of Jesus. If you get a feeling of discouragement, depression, sadness, no, the Bible says that we have the joy of the Lord in our heart. And you need to resist it and stand against it. Well, you might sit here and say, well, Pastor Michael, I really don't want to do that. Well, then that's fine. The devil will be your bunk buddy. He will be your companion. And the word says in Peter, it says he goes as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. He can't just devour anybody. He's looking for that open door. Right. And that's when the word of God says in the book of Ephesians, don't give place to the devil. And that word place means don't give him a spot. Right. And as soon as something comes, a thought, a feeling, or emotion, a lie, you need to resist it and stand against it. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
And this is not a Sunday morning thing. This is not just a Wednesday evening thing. You need to stand against it.
Amen.
24/7. Yeah. If you're dealing with sickness, if a feeling comes, oh, I'm feeling sick. No, you need to stand against it and resist it and fight the good fight of faith.
Yes.
You know, Pastor Michael, I got a lot of feelings. Feelings will change. Feelings will come. But the Word of God is eternal. It'll never change.
Yes.
And you and I need to stand. And the word says, having done all to stand, stand.
Yes.
Are you guys hearing me?
Yes.
All right. We got some good stuff here today. Notice this. Let's just go over here. I want you to see it. And we're going to go to, Cass, 1 second. How many love the word?
Amen.
Woo. Notice what it says here in the book of Proverbs, verse number 24, verse 10. Proverbs 24, verse 10. Excited for the word.
Yes.
How many are thankful? Everybody do this. How many are thankful you got breath in your body?
Yes.
But how many are cool about this? Even if our breath leaves our body, how many are excited to be absent from our body is to be present with the Lord?
Yes.
Isn't it awesome?
Yes.
That heaven is home and it's there and our loved ones are on the other side cheering us on.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, soon and very soon we're going to see the King. Glory
yes.
to God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Notice what it says here. I want you to see it. He says, if thou faint in the day of adversity, thy strength is what?
Small.
Everybody say small.
Small.
So look at the word for faint. Notice the word for faint. I want you to see slide number 39. He said, if you faint or I faint in the day of adversity, your strength and my strength is small. The word faint is this. This is what he's saying. If you do this, if you show yourself slack, in other words, you're not really being diligent about it. If you sow your, the word means to sink or to relax, to sink down like in a chair. You're just kind of, relaxing. If it means to let drop, it means to be disheartened. It means to withdraw. It means to relax. It means to refrain. It means to forsake. It means to let it alone. In other words, there's a problem. There's a challenge. There's an adversity, and you just let it alone. But the last part is this, to be quiet. He says, when the day of adversity comes, if you faint, meaning if you're just quiet and you're just kind of going with it and you're just saying whatever will be, the Bible says your strength is small.
Yes.
Are you guys hearing this?
Amen.
Notice what it says there in the New Living Translation. I want you to see it. How many love the word?
Amen.
We love the word here. We are excited about the word.
Yes.
Notice what it says here. It says, if you fail under pressure, your strength is not very great. Look at the slide number 40. Just a couple of different translations. Then we'll go to the Message Bible. How many love the word?
Amen.
He goes, if you give way in the day of trouble, your strength is small. The complete Jewish Bible says this. If you do nothing, actually, that's not the complete Jewish. It's the Holman Christian Bible. If you do nothing in a difficult time, your strength is limited. What is that saying? Man, when you got adversity, the devil's coming, he's roaring, and if you do nothing, your strength is small.
Yep.
Yeah. Look at the Message Bible. I want you to see it. How many love the word?
Amen.
How many love the word?
Amen.
Everybody say, I'm going to do something in Jesus' name. Notice it says, if you fall to pieces in crisis, there wasn't much to you in the first place.
Help me get stronger then, brother.
Isn't it the truth? He said, if you follow Peter. What does that say? You're going to feel things. You're going to feel pressure. The psalmist even said it like this. He said, the time that I'm afraid, I'll trust in you. Some people think like, well, if I'm serving God, I should have no feelings. I should not feel anything. You're going to feel some stuff. If you're believing God against sickness, you might feel pain. But what are you supposed to do? You need to resist and not be a do nothing. You're going to stand and you're going to fight and you're going to go no in the name of Jesus. Are you guys hearing this? Notice what it says in Isaiah, the 53rd chapter. We're going to go to verse number 12. How many love the word? We are excited. Ooh, we're getting it today. We are getting it today. Hallelujah. Notice what it says here in Isaiah. This is the great chapter that describes Jesus. It talks about how him going to the cross, by his stripes we were healed, who's going to believe our report. And he goes through all these wonderful things that he was. But notice the last part of this chapter says what he says here. He says, therefore, because of the redemptive work of what Christ was going to do, he said, he will divide him a portion with the great. Speaking about Jesus, Jesus is going to divide the portion with the great. He shall divide the spoil with who?
Strong.
With who?
The strong.
You. That's right. That's right. Me, the strong. He said he's going to divide the spoil with the strong. Why? Because he's poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and he made intercession for the transgression. But notice that statement there. It says he's going to divide, even though it's your spoil, even though it's your right, even though God has given you everything, you and I got to be strong. We're taking it.
Yes. Hallelujah.
You hear me? Notice what that word spoil, he said, he will divide the spoil with the strong. Look at verse number 36. And there's things that Jesus did and brought back and gave back and got back to us at the cross, the death, burial, and resurrection.
Yes.
He gave us healing. He gave us prosperity. He gave us peace. He's the restorer of our soul. He said he's going to divide the spoil. There's the Hebrew word. The word spoil means something that's drawn out of a battle. It's a plunder. It's a gain. It's the booty. Meaning valuable stolen goods, especially those seized in a war.
Yes.
When Jesus went to the cross, he whipped the devil pillar to post. Yes. He triumphed over him. Show up. The Bible says victoriously, right? Because of the cross. And there's spoils that we have. There's healing. There's prosperity. There's joy. There's peace. All these wonderful things that God has given to us. And he said, it's yours, but the strong take it by force.
Yes.
Are you guys hearing me? He said he'll divide it with the strong. Notice the word for strong. Slide 37. How many love the word?
Amen.
How many are excited for the word?
Yes.
How many are excited for the word?
Amen.
The strong is vast, numerous, powerful, or mighty. How many strong and mighty people beside our dear sister? How many are strong?
Yes.
Strong.
Yes.
He divides the spoil with the strong. Not those that are just like, I'm hoping and I'm praying and maybe someday. You know what God has given you and you take it.
Yes.
Amen.
Are you guys hearing me?
Amen.
Notice this. I want you to go with me. This is a great truth here. Look over to the book of 2 Samuel, the 23rd chapter. How many love the word?
Yes.
Ooh, we got it today.
Yep.
Everybody say, I'm strong.
I'm strong.
Isn't it interesting? He says that before he starts talking about the armor of God. He said, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Everybody say, I'm strong in Jesus' name. I'm not weak. I'm not mealy-mouthed. I am strong, and I'm not going to fail or faint, withdraw, relax in the time of adversity. I'm not going to just say, this is Blue Monday, Blue Tuesday. This is the day the Lord has made, and I'm going to rejoice. This is my day. This is my hour. I'm not some weak Christian. Bring it on, devil, in Jesus' name. Are you hearing me? That's a different mentality. It's a different mindset. Instead of, oh, Lord, please, maybe, if you could, look down from your glory in heaven and look down at me, little mouth me, Lord, please help me, help me. No, he's given you everything that you need and I need to walk and live in victory. Are you hearing me, church family? Whew, everybody, I'm strong. I'm blessed. I'm not going to take it. When depression comes, feelings come, visions come, thoughts come, immediately, don't meditate on it.
Right.
Don't talk about it with people.
Right.
Well, you know, I had this dream last night. I had these thoughts and all these visions in my head about I'm going to be sick. And I even had visions of my funeral and how I'm going to die or whatever, you know. No, you're going to throw those things out of your head.
Yes.
Immediately.
Yes.
Immediately.
Yes.
You know, the Bible says life and death is in the power of the tongue.
Yes.
Right? Our tongue, right?
Yep.
But how many know it's in the power of people's, other people's tongue?
Yes.
So they're either speaking life to us or they're speaking death to us.
Yes.
And when they're speaking life, we go, yay, hallelujah, I'll receive that. But if they start speaking death, you need to say no in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
If you're watching some commercial, and I mean, you need to mute them. If they're telling you about, well, if you got a headache, take this, but this will give you that, that, and the other thing, and you'll pretty, you got to say, no, that's not happening to me.
Yes.
If they say, well, when you turn 40, you turn 50, you turn 60, this is what you'd expect. No, that's not happening to me. You need to, why? Because those words, if you listen to them, they're seeds. They'll get inside you and they'll start growing and producing in your life.
That's right.
Oh, the economy or whatever's going on, it doesn't matter. We're blessed.
That's right.
Are you guys hearing me today?
Yes.
So it says this. Now these be the last, I'm sorry, Cass, let's go to verse 11, dear sister. This is talking about David's mighty men. And he says this. He says, and after him, he's talking about different ones. He talks about this one guy. He's one of my favorite. I can't wait to meet him in heaven. His name is Shammah. I probably should name one of my boys Shammah. I could see him now. They'd be shortening it and call him Sham, you know, but that's not good. But
no.
Shammah. But I love this guy. And he was the son of Egi, the Herite. And how many are glad that you're not the son of Egi? I guess if that could be a Herite. And notice this now. And he says, and the Philistines were gathered together in a troop, and there was a piece of ground full of lentils, and it said the people fled from the Philistines. So what we're getting here is that they planted some lentils. And so it's harvest time. How many know when you plant the word and you put the word in your heart, it's growing, right? When you're sowing seeds and you're giving your offering, right? And right when it's right ready for it to harvest, right when it's good and ripe, guess who's coming?
Yeah.
Everybody say the Philistines.
Philistines.
Notice what the word Philistine means. I want you to see it. Slide number 41. How many love the word? Hallelujah. The word Philistine means this, immigrants. Now, we're not against immigrants here. We love people. But I think people should come to our country the right way, right?
Right?
I'm a firm believer. My father had to come that way,
right?
So there's nothing wrong going through the channels, right? So whatever. So if you're, but the point is, a Philistine was a person who comes to this country to live permanently in a foreign country. But an illegal immigrant, which was the Philistines, because this wasn't their country, an illegal immigrant is this. It's a foreigner who has entered or resides in a country unlawfully or without the country's authorization. So what's happening here? They planted their garden, they got their lentils, and guess who comes? A foreigner. They have absolutely no rights, right? They're here unlawfully. This wasn't their land, and they're coming to take what belongs to you. That's exactly what the devil does to you and me. He comes to take what doesn't belong to him.
Yes.
He is an immigrant. He is a Philistine.
Yes.
Are you guys hearing me today?
Yes.
Go back to the scripture, my dear sister. And so he says, and after him was Shammah the son of Agi, right? And I can't minimize this. I just want you to see it. Notice the names for Shammah here in his father's name. Slide 42. His father's name, Agi. Right? It seemed like his grandfather, because we can look up the tree. So we just picture Aggie's father, the Herite, right? He's up here. And so he must have been a little bit more positive, right? Because he named his son Agi, which is actually a pretty good name, which means I shall increase. I mean, think it's a good name. Grandpa Shammah up here must have been pretty positive. And so he names his son Agi, which means I shall increase. Now, Agi must have got a pretty negative. I mean, he must have been looking at the circumstances, what was happening there. And so he names his son Shammah, which means loss, desolation, and astonishment. Now, I love Shammah, but the name's horrible.
Yeah.
Now, wouldn't you agree? I mean, how would you like for your parents to call you? You get born, and your name is I shall increase, and then you pass on this horrible meaning to this name, which means loss. He looks at his son and says, loss, desolation, astonishment. Ha! He could have been funny looking. I don't know what he looked like. I don't know what the deal was, right? Are you guys with me on this?
Yes.
So all Shema's life, he's living with that name. Every single time, and names meant something. Abraham, God changed his name. Abraham meant father of a many multitude, father of nations. And he had no kids. And so when people say, what's your name? He'd say Abraham. He said, oh, you must have a big family. And Abraham's like, I got by faith I do, but you know, show me your kids. They're not here. Names meant something, right? Esau, Harry, Red, Harry. Jacob came out. He was grabbing his brother's heel. He was a heel grabber. So when this kid was named, I shall, oh, loss, oh, desolation, astonishment. His whole life, he's living with this name. When anybody said, hey, Shema, how you doing? You know, they go, loss, desolation. They knew what that name meant. Are you guys hearing me? And so for a long time, Israel was not strong and they weren't powerful. There was no mighty men there. But then there came somebody by the name of David, a little shepherd boy. He was 17 years old, and David made a choice. For 40 days, Goliath came out and he taunted the children of Israel day after day. And they were afraid and they refused to engage. When you don't engage and you don't resist, the enemy will just linger there and you are in a holding pattern. And David was bringing cheese and bread from his father and he heard Goliath talk. And all of a sudden David said, hey, because he said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine? Yep. And they're all trying to calm down. He says, isn't there a cause? Who is he to talk about my God? He's uncircumcised. He's an immigrant. He's a Philistine. And all the mighty men were scared. We know the story. And then David, all of a sudden, Saul was trying to pawn off his armor. And David said, no, I can't fit. This doesn't fit right. It's not good. And he goes out there with what? Four stones or five stones, I think he got. Because Goliath had four more brothers. And he went with a sling. And big Goliath was there. See, this young little boy, this little lad, there's a new spirit. There's something happening in Israel. And God's anointing was on this young boy. Yes. Instead of running from the problem, instead of disengaging, he's like, yeah. And Saul says, Goliath, you know, sir, I'm going to feed you to the birds, and this is what I'm going to do to you. And David said, you come with a sword and a spear, but I come against you in the name of the Lord. Yes. And that's all you need to know. You got that name.
That's right.
And he said, this day, you're going to get defeated. This day, I'm going to cut your head off.
Yes.
And then you know the rest of it. David's running for years. Saul's trying to kill him. Jealousy there. But all of a sudden, the Bible says that there are certain people that got drawn to David. The weak, the discouraged, those that were in debt. The people that came to David were a bunch of losers. We would have looked at them and said, my goodness, these are weird loser people. But how many know what you hang around, what you associate with, you'll start catching some things. You'll start getting some things. That's why you got to get away from the losers and start hanging out with some winners, glory to God. You got to start hanging around with those people that know how to get a hold of God.
Yes.
Yes.
How to pray, believe God.
Yes.
And so these losers started to change. And all of a sudden, they became mighty men. And so Shema was one of those mighty men. All of a sudden, he starts going, hey, I'm going to kick off that loser name. Astonishment, loss, desolation. All of a sudden, he started realizing, God can use me. He looked at David and said, you know, I'm in covenant with Jehovah just like you are.
Yes.
Amen.
And he started to stir up in association. Go back to the scripture, my dear sister. How many love the word?
Amen.
How many love the word today?
Amen.
Are we getting it today? We're going, sure, I'm not getting through a lot, but maybe we got, how many know next week's coming too, right?
Amen.
So I don't want to dump the whole truck on you and then you walk out and go, what the heck did he say? We'll get you out of here.
No.
And he goes, after him was Shema, the son of Agi, the Hurite. And he goes, and these Philistines, they gathered together into a troop. I mean, there's a bunch of them.
100 people.
And there was a piece of ground. Everybody say a piece. Everybody say a piece. Everybody say a spot. Everybody say a little. He said there was just a little. I mean, no, Shema, we're going to see in a moment. He wasn't going to give them anything. He wasn't going to give the Philistine a piece. He said there was a piece of ground full. Everybody say full.
Oh.
I mean, that's the blessing of God in our life.
Yes.
And he said, what? He said, and the people, when they saw the Philistines, What did they do?
Fled.
They fled. Now, how many glad there's a verse of 12 to this? Because it's
good. Yes.
How many glad for this word? But he. How many know you don't need a troop with you?
That's right.
You got the power.
Amen.
You got the name of Jesus.
Amen.
He said, but he, what? He stood, not on the outer fringe, not on the back side of the thing, waiting for them to come. He stood right in the midst. He stood right in the midst. He stood right in the midst and of the ground and defended it. And guess what? It slew the Philistines, and the Lord wrought a great victory.
Yes.
Notice the word for stood. I want you to see it. It's a great word. How many love the word?
Amen.
Woo! Hallelujah. What did he do? Here comes, look at it. He's got two things happening. One, he's in the midst of his, one, all his buddies are leaving. And two, the Philistines are coming. And three, he stood in the midst. Notice that word for stood. He placed himself, he set or stationed himself. He presented himself. Here am I! I'm not running. I'm not yielding to this.
Right. Amen.
I'm not giving in. I'm not quitting.
Right.
Well, Pastor Michael, you know, they say 4 out of 5 preachers say that there's nothing you can do when the problems come. And what are we going to do? No! He stood in the midst of his garden. He stood. If you resist the devil, he will flee from you.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
How many like that?
Yes.
All right, let me give you one more scripture, guys. We're getting close. I got a lot here. We're having fun. We're having fun in the Holy Ghost. We're having fun.
Hallelujah.
Look at Matthew 18:18. Everybody say, I'm going to stand up.
I'm going to stand up.
Listen, that's what you got to do. The thought comes, the feeling comes, the emotion comes, the fear comes. You got to stand and say no.
That's right.
You got to do this.
Yeah.
Well, Pastor, I want you to do it for me. I'm not with you 24/7.
No. Give me the tools.
That's it. Give me the tools. It's like you here in the military, man. We have a few military guys. You get trained, you're like, well, Captain, I just want you to be with me. You know, if they come attacking me, I want you to kill them. No, we're training you so that you can stand up.
Yes.
We're showing you how to use the gun.
Right.
I want someone to use it for me. No, we're going to show you how to do it. And guess what? Once you start going at it, you're actually going to enjoy it.
Right.
Amen.
Not to killing people, you know what I'm saying? But if they're coming at you, I'll tell you what, you're going to go, ho, 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 ho. If I was fighting, that's how I'm going to fight.
Get some.
There was a movie. I don't know if anybody ever saw that. I'm going to date myself. Does anybody remember a movie called Over the Top?
Yes.
With Sylvester Stallone.
Yes.
You know? And so it was about this big arm wrestling competition. And so he was arm wrestling. He's trying to get. It's a good show. It's kind of good. His kid and everything. And so the cool part about that show, he'd walk up to the table and he'd have his baseball cap. Anybody got baseball? We're all the baseball guys. He had his baseball cap on normal, but as soon as he got to the table,
yeah,
he'd get his cap.
Turn it around.
Yeah. You know, when the devil comes and the pressure comes, you got to turn your cap around. It's okay.
Let's go.
We're in a war. Yeah. Let's go.
Yeah.
Instead of 4 out of 5 preachers say, oh, he's got a cap here. Give me that cap, John. Give me. You don't mind if I put it on? I don't got cooties. You like that, eh? John, you got a nice cap. I think I'm keeping it. All right. See, what do you do? You get that cap?
Yeah.
Turn around.
Yeah.
Do that. A little small for my head. But you getting it?
Yeah.
This time, no fuss, no muss. It's off. Oh. John. Yeah. I know you love Jordana. Oh, I'm sorry, sir. Jordan is good at fixing things. John, I love you. I'll replace that. John will buy you a new one. I'm kidding. I'll do it.
I need some more stickers.
All right. Look what Jesus said here. He said, verily I say unto you. Who is he speaking to? Whatsoever what? Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound where?
Hallelujah.
And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven.
Hallelujah.
Notice this word for bind. I want you to see it. He said, whatever you bind, slide number 16. We love the word. He says, whatsoever you shall bind. In other words, fasten with and throw into chains. Forbid. Prohibit. Put under obligation. Legally bound to do something. Say, no, stop it. The enemy starts to move. The enemy starts to do something. Whatever you bind, I forbid this in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I stop this spirit of fear. I stop you in the name of Jesus. I forbid this pain in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Stop. You're speaking. Whatever you bind on earth, it'll be loosed. And he says, whatever you loose. Look at the word for loose. I want you to see it. Slide number 17. How many love the word?
Amen.
Whatever you loose, set free. Something that's bound or fastened, undo, to destroy, to overthrow, to do away with. How many got some things you want to do away with?
Yes.
How many got some things you want to break, dissolve, deprive it of its authority?
Amen.
You can do it.
Hallelujah.
Stop it.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You loose. Father, I just thank you. I loose this right now.
Yes.
I dissolve this right now.
Yes.
Whatever you do. You can do it.
Yes.
Look at this. I want you to see look at that in the New Living Translation. We love the word.
Hallelujah.
We are getting it. He says, I tell you this, whatever you prohibit on earth is prohibited in heaven. And whatever you allow on earth is allowed in heaven.
Hallelujah.
Look at that, Jeremy. Oh, Cassie. Put the slide 18 up. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The Bible in basic English says this, truly I say to you, whatever things you fix on earth, by you, you can fix some things, will be fixed in heaven, and whatever you make free on earth will be made free in heaven. How many like that? How many think you can fix some things?
Yes.
God's Word translation says this, I can guarantee this truth, whatever you imprison, God will imprison, and whatever you set free, God will set free.
Hallelujah.
Are you guys hearing that?
Yes.
Look at that in the Message Bible, my dear friend. We excited today.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The message says this. When two of you, verse 18, dear sister. Take this most seriously. A yes on earth is a yes in him. See, this is it. When you say, yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm called. Yes, I'm healed. It's already healed. God's already did it, but you know, it's you. A no on earth is a no in heaven. What you say to one another is eternal. I mean this.
Yes.
How many like that?
Yes.
Everybody say, I got the power.
I got the power.
Say, I got the authority.
I got
all that I need.
I'm blessed.
I'm blessed.
I'm blessed.
All right, Josiah, let's come up here, buddy. Hallelujah.
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 You say, well, Pastor Michael, what do I do? Thank God you got the name of Jesus.
Yay.
So when that enemy comes, you say, in the name of Jesus, I resist you, you spirit of fear.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus, I resist you, poverty, and I just loose. Sometimes the devil's trying to hold up blessings, trying to hold up things. No, I release those finances.
Yes.
Release it in Jesus' name. You got it, son? Oh, okay. All right. We're going to actually do, we'll get the singers up, but we're going to do Jesus, your name is highly exalted. But we're going to pray for those precious ladies now. Joe and Leanne. We have some precious, precious dear sisters that watch us from a nursing home. They're very faithful, wonderful, faithful givers. We just love them, appreciate them so much. So they got neck, right? All right. Now this Joe and Leanne, right now where you are. You put your hand right on your head, put your hand on your neck, whatever, back. Right now. In the name of Jesus, we speak to that headache. We speak to that backache. We command it to go in Jesus' name. And right now we loosen that body, healthy, moving, muscles, cells, whatever needs to be done in Jesus' name. We say yes to healing for you and a yes on earth. Obviously, it's a yes in heaven in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Now, if you're here today, you've never, ever accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. It's wonderful. All you got to do is receive what he's done. Isn't that wonderful? Say this with me. Say, Father God, I receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior. What he did for me 2,000 years ago. Thank you, Lord, for your death, burial, and resurrection. You are my Lord. In Jesus' name. But if you're saved today and you're a Christian, you've never, ever, ever received the wonderful baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking with other tongues. You need, I need, we all need the power of God. You need the Holy Spirit. And so if you've never, ever, 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 while we're singing this song, I'm going to have Brother Andy come up. Pastor, if you could help. Because I got to play the drums of this song. We're going to pray for you. If you've never, ever received the Lord as the powerful baptism, you need it. I need it. We all need it. Come forward. We're going to pray with you, pray for you. Amen. And get what God's got for you. Amen. In Jesus' name. All right.
Hallelujah. The rest of you, let's stand to our feet. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yeah. hope to see you all on Wednesday night. Visit out there by the guest services. And of course, the cafe will be open. Just enjoy one another. Have a blessed day.